What is a woman of high value? I'm sure you all have heard this topic and have seen plenty of videos on it. But is being a high value woman and being a high value man the same to everyone? Or can it be subjective if you're, let's say, from a different culture or religion? And if it can be subjective, what those differences may be? Hello, my name is Greta Berishita. I'm dating and relationship coach for women. For the awesome high value women secrets, subscribe to my channel and hit the bell to be notified when I upload new videos every Wednesday and Sunday. And just before I share with you the 7 tips on what is a high value woman from the agnostic atheist point of view and what is a high value woman from a biblical side, don't forget to take my free self-awareness test to find out are you a woman of high value or low value, which I will drop in the video description box below. And if you like my merch, Chase Goals and Non-Drama, you can get this in my YouTube store. Before I start this video, I also want to say that even a year ago, and if you will look at my videos, let's say from over a year ago, you will see that what I describe as high value woman, it's more agnostic type of you rather than biblical. However, in this last year, I really gave my soul to God and I'm looking more at the biblical side of you of high value. But because before I was like a really big Christian, very agnostic, I would say, I feel like I'm in a place to compare them both and share with you the similarities and differences. So without further ado, what is a woman of high value? The tip number one. So let's start with more like agnostic side. So she puts herself first. As in my previous videos, I used to say, put yourself first, chase goals, not drama, go for your goals, go for your dreams, go for your ambition, create a beautiful life for yourself, focus on the guy, don't chase him, you are in charge of your life, you're responsible for your life, life is short, live it to the fullest, get rid of all the negativity, get rid of all the drama, you are who you surround yourself with and just put yourself first and just go for it, right? And let a man fit into your life. This is more like agnostic point of view. Now, as biblically, a high value woman does not put herself first. Biblically, a high value woman puts God first. She's not in charge of her life. God is in charge of her life. She follows her destiny. She follows her purpose. She follows the path that God has for her. Whatever a biblical high value woman achieves in her life, she praises and thanks God for it. Number two characteristic of a high value woman. So if you look at more like agnostic way, she loves herself. Agnostic form of self-love is putting yourself first, is treating yourself well, giving yourself lots of self-love affirmations, basically more like living for yourself, enjoying your life, living it to the fullest, as they say. That is self-love from a spiritual agnostic way. Now, if we look at self-love from a biblical way, in the Bible, it does not say love yourself. It says God loves you and God loves everybody equally. Therefore, we all have equal value in God's eyes because we are all brothers and sisters. We are all children of God. Your self-love, your self-value should not even be questioned because God loves us all the same. And in the Bible, it does not say love yourself. Actually, it says love thy neighbor as you love yourself. So if we look at this angle, biblical high value woman, they don't base decisions in life on self-love. They base decisions in life on what is the right thing to do. You're not looking just at your own life, you're looking how your decisions will influence not just you, but the people around you as well. Number three characteristic of a high value value woman is having boundaries. So when you are agnostic or an atheist, a lot of times when you're just putting yourself first, aim is you, and your aim is what's best for you and how to achieve things that are the best for you, right? So when you're in a relationship and you're both thinking the same way, setting in boundaries is more from a place of winning. So who will win in a relationship? Who will have the power over who? Because if you love yourself, your priority is you. So you set in a boundary to win. This is why men start to play so many power games with women, because we want to win in a relationship. We want to have more power over you. Now, biblically, when it comes to boundaries, it's a bit easier, because when you do the wrong thing, biblically, you're sinning. You're disobeying God. You believe in God and you sin, you feel guilty and ashamed. When you feel guilty and ashamed, automatically you will not want to sin again. So biblically, for example, flirting with other women, watching porn and etc., these are very sinful things to do. So when a man or a woman does these things, she's bound to feel guilty and ashamed. When you feel guilty and ashamed, you will not want to do these things again, because you will see them dishonorable to yourself and to your partner, which in return makes it easier to set in boundaries. You will not have to go to your husband and tell him, like, look, you have to stop watching porn. He will not accuse you back on being jealous or not modern enough or being crazy. Biblically, what he's doing is seen as a sin, is seen as a problem, and is seen as the wrong thing to do. Behaving this way, you're sinning against God and breaking marriage vows. Yes, of course, biblically, people can set in boundaries too, and there are three perfect examples of that. For example, God the Father in the Old Testament used to punish people for sinning against him. Jesus would give a disapproving look, and the Holy Spirit leaves your body if you curse or if you insult the Holy Spirit. So just by reading the Bible, you can see three types of godly examples of boundaries. Number four characteristic of a high value woman: differences between men and women. So this is where I feel that women and men who are agnostic or atheistic suffer the most. Because people who are non-believers, they believe in evolution a lot, believe that we as humans are always evolving, which somewhat I do agree with that too, like the technology, the science, of course, are evolving, or that men and women are the same. So women who believe in that, they have one-night stands easily, because if a man can do it, I can do it too. They obviously chase their goals and dreams and ambitions, and there is nothing wrong with that, which I definitely agree with. They compare themselves to men all the time, they compete with men, they offer 50-50 in a relationship. Of course, not all women that are agnostic or atheistic believe that men and women are the same. Plenty of women believe in differences between men and women, and I used to be one of them too. But then, when you believe in differences between men and women, and you're dating another man who considers himself, let's say, for example, agnostic, you're gonna have a lot of friction with him, as he will be manipulating you into thinking that men and women are equal, meaning the same. So he will be saying things such as, let's just have sex and enjoy the moment, we equal when the dates are 50-50. Basically what I'm saying, if you're agnostic and you believe in differences between men and women, you're gonna be fighting for your feminine rights with a man constantly. He will be telling you that you're old-fashioned, you are wrong, you need to be more logical, and you need to keep up with society. So basically, there is going to be a lot of power games, a lot of friction constantly. Whereas, if we look from the biblical point of view, women and men really understand that men and women are different. For if you are a godly woman, it's much easier to date a godly man because you automatically know that you're there to complement each other. So dating automatically becomes more enjoyable for a woman as you know what to expect from a man and how he should be treating you on the dates, which will make the dating much more enjoyable and fun automatically as a man will be pursuing you, charming you, being generous to you, sweeping you off your feet. As you as a woman will just have to be receptive, acting ladylike, enjoying the moment and being feminine. Number 5, traits of a high value woman, divorce. So when it comes to agnostic, atheistic point of view, divorce is not an extremely heavy topic. And you know, a lot of people even get a divorce when there is a money issue, when somebody gets sick, when you start to think differently, when you fall out of love with each other. Whereas if you look from a biblical point of view about a divorce, biblically, God, and I know some people might, some Christians might argue with me, but biblically, and I'm talking from a Catholic's point of view, you're basically allowed to get married in the church one time. So when you get married, you don't get married until you fall out of love. You get married until death does you apart. Marriage is very, very sacred union. It's a sacrament. It's a covenant between two people and you stay with each other until death does you apart. So marriage and a family is a very, very strong, big deal in Christianity. Therefore, it's taken extremely seriously. And yes, of course, technically you can get a divorce, but if you get a divorce after getting married in a church the second time, I know with Catholics, you cannot marry the second time in the church anymore. I think the only two reasons you can actually get a divorce if you are living a life by biblical standards is if the husband or the wife cheats on you, or if a husband or wife abandons you. However, if you got a divorce, if he cheated on you, you cannot remarry. I think only if the husband or the wife dies, this is the only exception that you can remarry again biblically. So if you're marrying for life until death does you apart, makes you really consider the other person's values, the other person's beliefs, the other person's points of view in life, and as when you're choosing that partner is with you for life. Number 6, characteristic of a high value woman is emotional control. And let's start with agnostic first. So if we look at women that are agnostic, a lot of them, let's say, copy guys, not all, but a lot of them copy guys. So we have one night stands, we have casual sex, we have casual dating, we chase for goals and dream, run the world, right? Women running the world, we compete with men. Obviously, this is very exhausting because you have so much on your plate as a woman. When you're gonna run your life this way, you're gonna have a lot of piled up emotions from casual dating, piled up emotions from casual sex, piled up emotions from trying to create your empire in a business, piled up emotions from competing with men. And because you have so many piled up emotions, of course you're still a woman who will automatically have more of loss of emotional control because there will be so many things on your plate. You will feel much more stressed. So if we look at the differences between men and women, men actually can handle much more stress than women because by science, men are much more chilled because we have testosterone, we are much more confident, whereas women, our hormones, we are a bit more protective of ourselves, we are a bit more neurotic, we are a bit more paranoid. However, if we look at the perspective of men and women being the same, And if we look at a more agnostic point of view, where men think that men and women are the same, men will keep accusing you of being crazy or being not normal if you lose emotional control. Because they will be thinking that men and women are the same. So if, as a man, I can handle my emotions under this level of stress, if I can be logical, well, then if we the same, she must feel the same way. Therefore, as a woman, you will have much, much more pressure to have your emotions in check, to have emotional control. If we look at the things now biblically, it's very clear in the Bible that men and women are different and that we are here to complement each other. And biblically also God tells the man to treat women with a more gentle manner as you would treat another man. Men are guided by God to treat women in a gentle way. Therefore, men are much easier on women when a woman loses emotional control, as we understand that men and women are different. Saying that biblically, as a woman, you are encouraged to be wise, control your emotions, and listen to your brain. Biblically, as a woman, you are encouraged to guard your heart, to not wear your heart on a sleeve. If you follow these biblical principles, of course, it helps you with emotional control as well, because we tend to lose emotional control when we are manipulated. We get manipulated when we wear our heart on a sleeve, when we don't guard our heart, when we perhaps speak too much. Biblically, it also says don't speak too much, because when you speak too much, you share too many things that you shouldn't share, and you usually say something silly that you cannot take back anymore. At the same time, if you are a godly woman married to a godly husband and you're married for life, that trust is really there towards your husband. Then you trust a husband 100%. As a woman, you will feel very safe and secure. Therefore, you will automatically lose emotional control much less. Number 7, forgiveness. When you are more like agnostic or atheist, when it comes to forgiveness, nowadays we are really influenced to forgive ourselves. So we go to therapy, psychologists, psychiatrists, where we talk about how you should forgive yourself and how you should not feel guilty or ashamed, and how you should forgive yourself and how you should let go of things. Biblically, you do not forgive yourself. Biblically, God forgives you. So biblically, you feel usually guilty or ashamed because you have done some sins in life. That's why you're feeling guilt, or that's why you're feeling ashamed, because you have done bad things in life. When you do bad things in life, you're accountable to God for it. So you go to God and you give him your sins and you ask him for forgiveness. You cry out to God, you talk to him, you ask him for forgiveness, and you promise not to do these sins again. So ladies, these were my 7 differences of high value woman when it comes to more agnostic point of view and a biblical point of view. Please let me know, what did you think about this video? I'm sorry for kind of generalizing again agnostics and atheists. I know we do not fall into the same category. It was just a bit easier for me to separate it this way. I told you before, I'm not here to judge. Everything what I shared in this video, I was following the agnostic atheist point of view even a year ago. Then I coach my clients. I'm here to sort your problems and help you out, whichever belief you have, whichever situation you're in. On top of that, I think a lot of people mix everything up. I think a lot of people take a bit of biblical, we take a bit of agnostic, we take a little bit of something else. My aim of this video is just to show you that high value is not black and white. High value can be very subjective according to culture or religion. And yeah, if you like this video, please press like. Let me know in the comments below, what did you think? Join Greta's High Value Woman School, where we are all in the same boat, learning how to be women of high value and bring out the best in our men. Follow me on my Instagram. My Instagram is called Ladies Relationship Coach. And for one-on-one with me or a member of my team, you can book me through my website called gretaberishita.com. And if you would like to know how to stay attracted via text, games, men, play on women, how to control your emotions, how to get your ex back, how to love yourself, or maybe you have a hobby that you would like to make into an online business, you can find all of these packages for sale on my website, gretaberishita.com, and I will put a link on where to get that as a pinned comment under this video and into my video description box below. So thank you for watching, my ladies. Kisses from Dorset. Mwah.